Hello everyone. In this video, I'll be talking about conductive hearing loss. Now, hearing loss is classified into organic or non-organic hearing loss. Organic hearing loss means we are able to identify some cause. However, if there is no identifiable cause, then it is termed as non-organic hearing loss. Organic hearing loss is further classified into conductive and sensorineural types. Conductive type of hearing loss means any pathology which hampers the conduction of sound from the external ear up to the stapedio-vestibular joint. It leads to conductive hearing loss. And sensorineural hearing loss, though we use the term sensorineural combined, but actually sensory neural loss means any pathology of the cochlea, which is the sense organ of hearing. And neural means any pathology either of the eighth nerve or the central auditory pathway. So neural is sometimes also called as retrocochlear pathology. So sensory neural can be either sensory, that is cochlear, or the neural or retrocochlear. But in this talk, I'll be only focusing on the conductive hearing loss. Now, conductive hearing loss can be either congenital or it can be acquired. And any pathology of external ear and middle ear up till the stapedio-vestibular joint will cause conductive hearing loss. So some of the common congenital anomalies are meatal atresia, that is either the external auditory meatus or the external auditory canal, it is not fully developed. So it is either there is atresia or it is stenosed. So it leads to conductive hearing loss. Then there can be congenital fixation of ossicles, like fixation of foot plate of stapes or fixation of head of malleus. It leads to conductive hearing loss. There can be ossicular discontinuity and congenital cholestatoma. So in congenital cholestatoma, there is a white mass behind the intact tympanic membrane, and the parents of the child complain that he or she is not hearing. So on otoscopic examination, a white mass is seen behind the tympanic membrane, and on further investigation, that is HRCT temporal bone, cholestatoma is confirmed. The most common sites of congenital cholestatoma are middle ear and petrous apex. So it is also one of the causes of conductive hearing loss in children. Then some acquired causes, they can be either in the external ear or in the middle ear. The common causes of external ear are wax. Wax is a secretion of ceruminous sebaceous glands along with keratinized squamous epithelium and debris. It leads to blockage of the canal. Then foreign body. Foreign body in ear is most commonly seen in children. It can be living foreign body, it can be a non-living foreign body, it can be vegetative or it can be non-vegetative. Then furuncle. Furuncle is the staphylococcal infection of the external auditory canal of the hair follicle. Now hair follicle are only present in the outer one-third of the canal, that is cartilaginous part. So if the hair follicle gets infected by staph aureus, it is called furuncle. Then any tumor of the external auditory canal. The most common benign tumors are osteoma and exostosis. Now they will block the canal and they will cause conductive hearing loss. Then otitis externa. It is the inflammation of the external ear, that is pinna and the external auditory canal, which leads to the edema of the canal and narrowing of the canal, and hence conductive hearing loss. Then the acquired causes in the middle ear are tympanic membrane perforation. It can be in acute otitis media, it can be in chronic otitis media. Perforation can be because of trauma also. Or fluid in the middle ear. Fluid in the middle ear is seen in acute otitis media, secretory otitis media, and also sometimes hemotympanum, where blood is collected in the middle ear because of trauma. Then any mass in the middle ear which can be benign or malignant mass, for example glomus tumor or any malignant mass, they will cause conductive hearing loss. Then ossicular disruption, acquired ossicular disruption. It can be traumatic or it can be because of the necrosis of the ossicles in chronic otitis media. And long process of incus is the most common ossicle to get necrosed because it has a limited vascular supply. Then ossicular fixation, for example, otosclerosis. It will also lead to conductive hearing loss. And eustachian tube blockage. In eustachian tube blockage, there will be negative pressure in the middle ear and the conduction of the sound will be hampered, leading to conductive hearing loss. The characteristic features of conductive hearing loss are, on tuning fork test, the Rene test will be negative. Negative means bone conduction will be better than ear conduction. Then Weber test will be lateralized to poorer ear. Now, if one of the ear is normal and the other is having conductive hearing loss, the Weber will lateralize to the side having the conductive hearing loss. If both the sides are having conductive hearing loss, then Weber will lateralize to the side which is having more conductive hearing loss, that is poorer ear. The absolute bone conduction test will be normal because the bone conduction, absolute bone conduction decreases in patients with sensory neural loss. It is normal in conductive hearing loss. Then pure tone audiogram, it will show ear bone gap. Bone conduction will be better than ear conduction. There will be an ear bone gap of at least 20 dB or more. And generally the lower frequencies are affected in conductive hearing loss. However, the speech discrimination is good. That is, patient is able to recognize speech. This is an example of a pure tone audiogram with conductive hearing loss. Here we can see that the ear bone gap is more than 20 decibels at almost all frequencies. So this is how a pure tone audiogram in conductive hearing loss looks like. The management of the conductive hearing loss depends on the etiology. So if there is any removal of the canal, if there is any canal obstruction in the form of wax, fungus, foreign body, it can be removed. If there is any fluid in the middle ear, then it can be removed by medication or if required by myringotomy to drain the fluid along with gromate if required. If there is mass in the middle ear, then it should be removed surgically. It will improve the hearing loss. Then for otosclerosis, the surgery of choice is stapedectomy, in which the superstructure of the stapes is removed, a fenestra or a hole is created in the foot plate of the stapes, and a Teflon piston is kept between the incus and the foot plate. So that is stapedectomy. Then if there is CSOM, tubotympanic type, then myringoplasty and tympanoplasties are done. If it is aticoenteral type, then Mastoid surgeries are done, mastoidectomies are done. And if the patient is aged or he is not fit for surgery or he does not want to get operated or the operation has failed, so in such patients, to improve the hearing, they can use hearing aids also. Now myringoplasty, it is one of the very common ear surgery performed everywhere. And myringoplasty, by definition, it means repair of the tympanic membrane. So the repair of the tympanic membrane, that is closure of the perforation, is done by using a graft material. Now graft materials can be either autografts or they can be either homografts. Autografts means the graft is harvested from the same person or the same patient. The examples of autografts can be temporalis fascia, perichondrium, cartilage. Sometimes fat is also used as a graft material and fascia lata also. But the most common autograft used is temporalis fascia. Now there can be three reasons for temporalis fascia to be a preferred graft material of choice. Reason number one is that it can be harvested from the same incision as the ear, from the incision with the ear surgery is done, that is either endoral or postoral incision. Reason number two is the thickness of temporalis fascia, it corresponds to the thickness of the tympanic membrane, that is around 0.1 millimeters. So the post-operative hearing results are good with temporalis fascia as compared to other graft materials. And reason number three is that temporalis fascia has a low basal metabolic rate, that is low metabolism. So it can survive even with minimal blood supply. Hence, chances of its take-up rate are more as compared to other graft materials. That is why temporalis fascia is one of the most preferred graft materials for ear surgery. Then some homografts that can be used from cadavers, they can be dura, they can be vein grafts, they can be cadaver tympanic membrane. However, these are very, very rarely used. Most of the times, autografts are used. Then based on the placing of the graft material, myringoplasty can be of two types. It can be underlay, it can be overlay. Now underlay and overlay, it is with respect to the annulus of the tympanic membrane and not with respect to the handle of malleus. So if the graft material is medial or below the tympanic annulus, it is called underlay method, and if it is lateral to the annulus, it is called overlay method. Underlay method is relatively easy to perform. However, the disadvantage can be then it leads to a narrow middle ear. But the advantage is the chances of lateralization of graft are less, and there are very less chances that any epithelium is left medial to the graft, which can in the future lead to the formation of epithelial pearls or cholesterol granulomas or cholesterol pearls. In overlay grafting, the graft is placed lateral to the tympanic annulus. So there are chances that some epithelium may be left medial to the graft, and which in future can lead to the development of cholesteatoma pearls or cholesterol granulomas. The advantage of overlay grafting is that it gives a good middle ear space, but sometimes it is difficult as compared to underlay grafting. The second common surgery performed in ear is tympanoplasty. Now tympanoplasty, it is eradication of disease from the middle ear with reconstruction of the ossicles and with repair of the perforation. So it contains three components. First is eradication, which is most important. Second is ossiculoplasty, that is repair of ossicles. And finally, it is myringoplasty. Now for any ear surgery, to give good post-operative hearing, there are certain principles which should be kept in mind. The first is that there should be an intact tympanic membrane. That is, every attempt should be made to repair the tympanic membrane with a graft material. Similarly, there should be intact ossicular chain so that sound is conducted properly to the stapes or the oval window. Then there should be two functioning windows, that is oval window and round window, because when the sound goes to the oval window, it leads to the movement of the perilymph, and that pressure is released through the round window. If any of the windows is not functioning, then there is the movement of the fluid will not be proper, and hence the functioning of both windows is required. Then there should be acoustic separation of the two windows. Now we know that sound is a physical wave of compression and rarefaction. So when the wave of compression is hitting the oval window, the round window should be in the opposite phase. That is, there should be phase of rarefaction over the round window. Then only there will be effective movement of the perilymph, which will lead to the generation of the electrical impulse. If both the windows are in the same phase, then the movement is cancelled and there is no electrical impulse generated. Another important point is that the eustachian tube should be functioning properly. Now clinically we get an idea of the functioning of the eustachian tube by asking the patient if they are able to hear the drops coming in the when they instill the drops in the ear, whether they are coming in the throat or not. It indirectly indicates that the eustachian tube function is normal, but otherwise there are other eustachian tube tests which should be done preoperatively to ascertain the function of the eustachian tube, like the Toynbee test, Politzer test, eustachian catheterization and all that. And finally, the eighth nerve and the cochlea should be functioning normally. There should be no sensory neural component in the hearing loss of that patient, which cannot be treated by myringoplasty and tympanoplasty. Now, Wolstein proposed a classification in which he divided the tympanoplasty into five types. So type 1 tympanoplasty, it is similar to myringoplasty, where only the graft material is used to repair the tympanic membrane, the ossicular chain and middle ear are normal. In type 2, there is partially eroded ossicular chain, but that ossicular chain is functional. So the graft is placed over the partially eroded ossicular chain. In type 3, the malleus is absent or eroded, incus is absent. So graft is placed over the stapes head. So it is also called columella tympanoplasty or myringostapidiopexy. In type 4, now only the stapes footplate is present. So the stapes footplate is present, it is functional, the superstructure is absent, malleus absent, incus absent, stapes superstructure absent, only stapes footplate is present. So that stapes footplate, it is exteriorized to the external ear and the round window is closed with a graft. So that is called round window shielding effect. In this condition, what will happen? The sound from the external ear will directly hit the oval window. so that the oval window and the round window are at there is acoustic separation between the two windows. So this type of tympanoplasty is also called round window shielding effect. Type 5 tympanoplasty, in which malleus is absent, incus is absent, stapes superstructure is absent, stapes footplate is present, but it is fixed. So it is not functional. So a separate window, that is a third window, is created at the most commonly in the horizontal semicircular canal, and some and the graft material is kept over that window, and now that window acts as oval window. So this is fenestration operation. Now there is one more term which is called sono inversion, which is also sometimes called type 6 tympanoplasty, in which the graft is placed over the round window. So now the function of the round window is being done by oval window and vice versa. So that is called sono inversion, but it is not a very routinely common done procedure. It is just for theoretical purpose. So this is a figure which explains the different tympanoplasties. Here we can see type 1 tympanoplasty, ossicular chain is normal, so only graft is kept. In type 2, there is partially eroded ossicular chain. In type 3, we can see myringosclerpidopexy, type malleus incus are absent, but stapes superstructure or head is present where the graft is placed. Type 4, we can see that even the superstructure is absent, so that part that is stapes footplate is exteriorized and round window is shielded with a graft. And in fifth, the stapes footplate is fixed, so a separate window at the horizontal semicircular canal is created and a graft is placed over it, and that window now acts as oval window. Another component of tympanoplasty is ossiculoplasty, that is repair of the ossicle or hearing mechanism. For that, autografts and homografts are used. Most commonly autografts are used, and they are the incus, that is auto incus. The partially eroded incus is taken out, it is re-sculptured and remodeled, and then it can be used again. And cartilage, the most common cartilage used is tracheal cartilage. Conchal cartilage can also be used. So incus and cartilage, these are very commonly used autografts for ossiculoplasty, and they have a very good post-operative results. Sometimes homografts can be used, like ossicles from other persons. Now prosthetic implants are also increasingly used nowadays. They are made up of Teflon or hydroxyapatite. So they can be either TORP or PORP. TORP is total ossicular replacement prosthesis. It is used when malleus is absent, incus is absent, stapes superstructure is also absent. So this TORP is placed between the tympanic membrane and the stapes footplate. And then PORP is partial ossicular replacement prosthesis. It is used when malleus and incus are absent, but stapes superstructure is present. So PORP is kept between the graft and the stapes head. Now we have seen so many causes of conductive hearing loss. So the average hearing loss in different conditions is given in this table. So if the ear is completely occluded with wax or any foreign body or any tumor, any mass, the average hearing loss will be in the range of 30 decibels. If there is tympanic membrane perforation, then the hearing loss can be can range from 10 to 40 decibels. Now that will depend on the side and site of perforation. Now it is stated that the smaller perforations have less hearing loss as compared to larger perforations, and generally anterior perforations have less hearing loss as compared to posteriorly located perforations. Now there are two conditions. One is ossicular interruption with intact drum, that is single pathology, and second one is ossicular interruption with perforation, that is double pathology. Now here we can see that in single pathology hearing loss is more, that is if there is ossicular interruption with intact drum, the hearing loss, average hearing loss, is 54 decibels. If there is perforation as well as interruption, the hearing loss is less, 38 decibels. Now one of the reasons can be that whenever there is intact drum and ossicular interruption, so the sound reaches the oval window and the round window in the same phase, so there is no acoustic separation, which leads to more hearing loss. However, if there is ossicular interruption with perforation, then the sound, there is conductive hearing loss because of the perforation, but the sound reaches the oval window first, and so there is some, though less, but some acoustic separation is still present. and that is why the degree is of hearing loss is less as compared to intact drum with ossicular interruption. Then if there is malleus fixation, then the average hearing loss can be between 10 to 25 decibels. And if there is closure of the oval window, then the hearing loss is maximum, that is 60 decibels.